really important that we begin to change the mindset of young people to know that your vote counts.
They don't understand that the legislative arm of government is actually a co-equal arm of government.
We have an incredible amount of potential.
Whatever it is I was doing, because of my personal DNA, it had to be of an international standard, which is what, seriously speaking, is all about.
Yes, welcome to the show this week. Last week, we were speaking, as you know, with Honorable Abdulmumin Jibrin, and he made a lot of allegations, as it were, because I haven't spoken to the other parties. But the truth is, the reason we're doing this show is for you to understand what's driving this man that some people think you're a social activist. Are you a social activist? I'm sorry. Are you a social activist? Well, you're behaving like a social activist.
I got a bit inspired by the governor of Kaduna State, and I tried to...
The current governor of Kaduna State.
He's one of my inspiration. I'm not particularly close to him, but I like a couple of things that that he's done. And I picked a word from his book, Accidental Public Servant, and I said I'm an accidental... activist. I said that is what I want to do for the rest of my life. Putting in a lot of energy in the fight against corruption with a specific, with focus on the House of Representatives. People prefer me to say the National Assembly, but I said I'm not a senator, I've never been one. And I don't want to go into a territory I do not really understand. Mm-hmm. But I know that I understand the wider society, how corruption it's done, and how you can deal with corruption in the short term, medium term, and longer term. And using the case of the House of Representatives, using the House of Representatives
as an example.
So in the case of the House of Representatives, for whatever it's going to cost me, the maximum penalty is my life. And if there's anything that people fear for me, it's my life.
I think your family must be worried about it.
Oh, absolutely. They're very, very worried. My family is very, very worried. But again, somehow you will die, no matter what it is. If somebody kills you, he's also going to die. He might not even live as long as he thinks he's
going.
So I don't even want to. I'm not afraid about my kids whatsoever. It's going to happen. Will happen.
It appears to me also that you probably growing up, you always wished you were a superhero. Because what you're doing now is turning out to be like, I want to change. Even if I die, I'm telling you the truth. You're sounding like Superman.
No, I've always been in the social media, but this crisis actually got me deeper into the social media. And I follow up a lot of things. I follow a lot of people, what they say and the rest. I peep on the settings. But there's a lady that wrote something. I think she just wrote it randomly. I never told her. Mm-hmm. I picked it and I kept it. Because it captured me. She said, she said, it seems this guy has always wanted to be a hero in his life. In the thick of the whole crisis. Yes, you're right. I've always admired that kind of Mandela stuff. I've always wanted to be that person who liberates people. And I'm saying this with every sense of genuity. That's just what I want. I want my kids to move on the street and, oh, who are you? I'm son of Jibrin or whatever. Which of the Jibrin? This Jibrin. And they embrace
Even if you don't have money.
Even if you don't have money. So this is the person I've always wanted to be. But because I also came from a product of the establishment, and people find it very difficult to reconcile that. Is it true this boy could be what he is trying to make us to believe? But this is who I am. Those who are quite close to me understand that this is what I've always known. But also I came from also a fairly stronger background. Picking a degree in Nigeria here, a master's, of course. I read politics and diplomacy to my PhD level. Then did my postgraduate leadership at the Harvard. Of course, I went to the London Business School, did management. Then did my MBA at the Swiss.
Were these calculated moves on your side?
Yes, I was preparing myself. But at the same time, while I was running my business, I was still schooling all the way till date. Mm-hmm. I picked my MBA at the Swiss Business School, and I've attended a large pool of courses before coming to the house. Then set up my company about a decade before coming to the house. That turns out to be successful. And if I weren't in the House of Representatives, probably I would have been into massive production today.
Manufacturing,
etc. And now I went into the House fairly prepared, and so my perspective was different. But there are a couple of members also that their perspective it's different. But it's difficult to operate under that kind of atmosphere when you have about 75% or 80% of the members.
What was your perspective? Or what is your perspective?
Yes, while I was going into the House, you just believe, okay, you will go and things will work out. You have people who actually believe that you have to change the country and things have to work very well. Why are you not opening these? Or hold your town hall meetings with your constituency, have a vibrant constituency office. And, you know, you have all these ideas and everything. And you just go there and you discover that it's money. The field pain, they're abusing me, why is he talking like this? And but that's fact, that's why they can't come out to deny it.
Can you blame members for thinking money, if the populace themselves, because I always get this from members, there's a demand on you, even from the electorate?
Absolutely. Now, the point is that Nigeria is in such a crossroad. Now, where do you start fighting corruption? From the top? Or from the bottom, because you need to analyze it properly. And that is why sometimes some of the strategies we adopt to fight corruption becomes a bit difficult. I do agree, because of our situation, you have to fight it from both ways. While I was chairman of finance, I had suggested, which people thought it's a bit crazy, and I keep telling them that, look, if you have such a terrible mess, you must do something crazy to be able to get it right. I said, okay, the AFCC, if you are arresting people that steals money, then when you look at the chain and the causes, maybe pressure from lower people, you need to also have a law that can also deal with somebody who comes to ask a public officer for what he does not have. For instance, if you have a young man who is just an employee in the central bank and he earns take-home pay of about 200,000, 250,000, then because you are a village chief from his village, you come and ask him to buy you a car of 2.5 million naira. You're asking the boy to go and steal. You should be arrested. The boy should be able to have evidence that you're asking him to buy that for you and should take it. You should be arrested. So the public will also know that even if you call yourself a masses, then you go again, you are asking a public officer what it's beyond his salary is an offense. But that's just one side of it. We're talking about the bigger society. I want us to narrow it to the House of Representatives. In the case of the House of Representatives, the major reason why you see there is corruption there is because of that running cost.
You keep saying that. I'll take a break at this point. We'll be right back with Honorable Abdulmumin, if you don't go away.
Clearly explain how this money will be disbursed. The only gap that was identified as a den was even though they provided the categories of beneficiaries, members were interested in knowing the identity of the beneficiaries. It was a bit impossible as at then to be able to identify the identity of the beneficiaries because the implementation has not commenced. I know that the Committee on Poverty, Mr. Speaker, I need your protection. Mr. Speaker, I need your protection.
Order, please. Order. Honorable members.
Honorable members, please. Please allow him to round up his debate, please.
Silence, please.
Allow him to
Silence,
round
please.
Up his debate.
I know that we have the legal framework right in this house. Nobody should play politics with that intervention. The government has a good intention. It should be allowed. We should not play politics with it. The framework is right in the House of Representatives, and it is right here. Please, honorable colleagues, this program should not be used for politics. It is not politics. This government has a good intention, and it should be allowed to implement it.
Yes, that obviously proves that, I mean, my guest has always spoken out, right? And I wonder, though, where were you when you heard that you had resigned and fired? I know which it is now, but you were waiting for 10 p.m., but it was announced, obviously, at 9 o'clock news.
No. We were in the chamber. Of course, I told you we were in the chamber. I went up to tell him that I have said to you that I want to go. And he said, please allow me today. Let's talk by 10 o'clock. So I left the chamber. And I think I heard that there was a lot of discussion between himself, Leo Ogo, Alhassan Dogua. They were all discussing how to die. And I think they decided that, look, this guy is determined to leave. And if he leaves, he will start exposing what is going on here. So the best way to go about it is to say that we've taken a decision already to sack him so that we can critically create a problem for him. So I was seated in my office, and one of my legislative aide walks in and said to me that the speaker announced that you've resigned. Because he said, I resigned. Then he said, they fired me. So the young man had resigned. So, and it was later on in the evening, I had the full...
What did you do when he told you that? Did you try to go back and...
No, of course. Why do I need to
just
go back?
To
I've already made up my mind that I was going. After all, I already had an office before going to the house. So what I did from that place, I just addressed the press, and from there, I went to my private office.
You told us earlier that what's most important to you, not necessarily to bring one leader down or one person down, but to ensure that the issue of the running costs of the house is addressed, because it creates room for corruption.
I know that if Dogara is going to accuse me of everything, he will not say Jibrin is not moderately smart or intelligent. Not too smart or too intelligent. I'm not. I'm an average person. He will at least credit me with a minimum intelligence. And so if solely my focus is to get Dogara out, I would never raise the running cost issue. Because in the whole House of Representatives, 90% of members are in agreement with me on every other issue except running costs.
Final words to Nigerians who are still saying they are not serious. What should they be doing? Final word.
Well, what I will just say is that I will adopt the apology that I gave severally. I said that, yes, please, I've been part of the establishment. I'm a product of the establishment. But I said, I have drawn a massive line when I became, when I turned 40. I said, forgive me. If you are pissed off that I was part of the system all my life or in the last 5 years, but I said I'll make it up for you by standing on my feet without retreating, and I will continue to expose corruption in the House of Representatives, and I will continue to take actions that will ensure that this country achieves its aspiration. As much as I can. But if in the course of serving the country in the last 5 years or so, I have committed any offense, I also want to go and I also want to be investigated and face the penalty.
You're open to be investigated.
I'm open to be investigated.
And by the way, seriously speaking, it's open to anybody who wants to comment or accuse him, really. It's up to, whatever it is. So we're going to make inroads to also speak to other members of the House, but that's what it's been like today. I must thank you, Jibrin, for being so open with us.
Thank you
But
so
you're
much.
Always open, that's the truth.
Thank you.
But just finding people to understand you and knowing that, and it's only God that knows where this is going to end, really. I feel sorry for your wife and children, though.
Thank you.
And your mother and your father. But that's the way it is. That's been Seriously Speaking right here live in Abuja.